enjoying this, but I should like to get to my door.
Ah, Peter. Yes, you're quite right. I should be getting on with all those letters to the children.
Now, though I first told Cousin Stephanie how little Lucy Carr first encountered Mrs. Tiggywinkle, I really think it only fair that Lucy should see how it all turned out. So, I shall instead send Cousin Stephanie the latest news of Mr. Jeremy Fisher. I'm sure little Lucy has many happy memories of our mutual friend, dear Mrs. Tiggywinkle, from whom, in fact, I first heard what had befallen that unfortunate frog, Mr. Jeremy Fisher.
Once upon a time, there was a little girl called Lucy, who lived at a farm called Little Town. She was a good little girl, only she was always losing her handkerchiefs.
Oh, where is it? It's not in this pocket. Definitely gone. I've lost my pocket handkin. That's three handkins and a pinafore. Oh, dear. Have you seen them, Tabby Kitten? Sally Hennypenny, have you found three pocket handkins? Oh. Well, that wasn't very helpful. Was it, Tabby Kitten? Not in here. Robin, have you seen my handkins? Oh, where can they be? I walked down here the other day with Miss Potter. Perhaps if I go the same way, they must be along here somewhere. Someone? Excuse me, sir.
Oh, bless my soul.
Have you seen my pocket handkins? Or even a pinafore?
Afraid not, young lady.
Thank you, sir. I shall have to keep looking then.
Sorry, I can't be of more help. Eh, what?
Mama is not going to be pleased.
Well, best of luck, my dear.
Goodbye.
Whatever would I be doing with pocket handkins?
Oh, bother. La la la. Oh, what's that? I'm sure I can see some little pieces of white. They might just be my lost handkins. Goodness! Who could have put such a tiny bucket there? It's no bigger than an egg cup. Oh! And look at those tiny little footmarks. They must have been made by a very small person. Oh. I wonder who lives here.
Smooth and hot, and rusty spot. No,
forgive me.
Oh, who's that?
I'm Lucy. I didn't mean to startle you, but who are you? And have you seen my pocket handkin?
Oh, yes, if you please, My name is Mrs. Tiggy Winkle. I'm an excellent clear starcher. Please, do make yourself comfortable. It is rather warm in here, I know.
Thank you, Mrs. Tiggy Winkle. What's that thing? That's not my pocket handkin.
Oh, no, if you please, That's a little scarlet waistcoat belonging to Cock Robin.
No, that isn't my penny.
Oh, no, if you please, That's a damask tablecloth belonging to Jenny Wren. Look how it's stained with currant wine. It's very bad to wash.
There's one of my pocket handkins. And look, there's my penny.
Fancy that. They were there all the time. Well, I knew I'd got them somewhere. I'll just put the iron over them and gather those.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Tiggy Winkle.
Well, now, where did I leave my goffering?
Now, who could that possibly belong to?
That's Sir Isaac Newton's. Not that your mama would wish me to be discussing gentlemen's attire with you, if you please, There.
Oh, that is lovely.
Another of my specialities, if you please, Now then, just give me a moment.
Goodness, what are they? They seem to have fingers instead of feet, or perhaps they are gloves.
Oh, that's a pair of stockings belonging to Sally Hennypenny.
Stockings?
Look how she's worn the heels out scratching in the yard. She'll very soon go barefoot.
Why, there's another handkerchief. But it isn't mine. It's red.
Oh, that one belongs to old Mrs. Rabbit. And it did so smell of onions, I've had to wash it separately.
What are these dear, soft, fluffy things?
Oh, those are woolly coats belonging to the little lambs at Skelgill.
Do their jackets take off?
Oh, yes, if you please, Look out the sheep mark on the shoulder. This one's marked for Geesgaff, and three that come from Littletown.
And what are you doing now?
I always has to starch these little dicky shirt fronts. They're Tom Titmouse's in his most terrible particular.
How smart.
There. Now I've finished my ironing. I'll just hang these up to air. And I'd take it very kindly if you would hand the things up to me.
Of course.
Thank you, my dear.
Dear me, what happened to this?
Now, there's a story. As I heard tell, young Master Peter had a narrow escape from Mr. McGregor's garden.
Help! Mr. McGregor!
Stop, thief! Come back here, you wee pest!
Lucky to get out with his skin by all accounts, but the jacket was left behind, and what with the rain and all. Well, I does my best. Look, even the buttons are gone.
Gracious.
Then Mrs. Tiggy Winkle and Lucy sat down to take some tea.
And the last I heard.
All through Mrs. Tiggy Winkle's gown and cap, there were hairpins sticking wrong end out, so that Lucy didn't like to sit too near her.
I wasn't expecting a visitor this afternoon. Now, I always slip the key under here, and we'll be off. Now we'll go and deliver the washing.
Where shall we be going first?
Well, if you please, down in the wood below is the big fir tree, so we shall call our Mrs. Rabbit first.
I hope she can match those buttons.
Seeing as it's not the first time, nor yet the last, I'm quite sure Mrs. Rabbit keeps a job.
Then away down the hill trotted Lucy and Mrs. Tiggy Winkle with the bundle of clothes.
Hello, Mrs.
The very first little animals they met were Peter Rabbit and Benjamin Bunny.
Hello.
Tell you, Mama, I've done
Tiggy
my very best with the jacket, but as
Thank you
can see...
I will, Mrs. Tiggy Winkle. little animals and birds were so very much obliged to dear Mrs. Tiggywinkle. So at the bottom of the hill, there was nothing left to carry except one little bundle. And that belonged to Mr. Jeremy Fisher.
What will they get up to next?
Mr. Jeremy Fisher, a most elegant and gentlemanly frog, lives down by the lake.
I do believe I saw him fishing when I was searching for my handkins.
Oh!
Dear me, do take care, Mrs. Tiggywinkle.
I'm not as young as I used to be. Mind how you go, Miss Lucy, with your clean boots. Water and mud everywhere. Don't know how it can be. So, there. A gentleman has a right to live how he will. Gooey! Mr. Jeremy!
Ladies! Ahoy!
I was just about to leave your clean washing and collect from the porch as usual, Mr. Jeremy, sir.
Ah, yes. I mean, no, dear lady. Afternoon, ma'am.
How do you do?
Afraid I have some rather dirty linen here in this basket, so as not to muddy your gown.
In the basket? Bless my soul. Oh, dear mercy me, Mr. Jeremy.
Little mishap. That is to say, well, not so little, really. More of an accident. Very nearly fatal. Skin of my teeth and all that, don't you know?
Mercy me, Mr. Jeremy. What have you done to your poor fingers?
Oh, they're the very least of it.
Oh, Mr. Jeremy.
Much worse happened than a few scratched fingers, I assure you. A really frightful thing it would have been had I not been wearing my Macintosh. It's a tale that hardly bears telling. In fact, I still feel a little faint at the recollection. And yet the day had started so well. But let me start from the beginning. Ah, nice drop of rain. Be good fishing today, I shouldn't wonder. I'll get some worms and catch a dish of minnows for my dinner. If I catch more than five fish, I'll invite my friends Mr. Alderman Ptolemy and Sir Isaac Newton. The alderman, however, eats salad. Now then, Macintosh. Galoshes. Now, where did I leave? 40 much sandwiches. I know just the place for minnows.
Mr. Jeremy settled himself cross-legged and arranged his fishing tackle. He had the dearest little red float. His rod was a tough stalk of grass, his line was a fine long white horsehair, and he tied a little wriggling worm at the end. The rain trickled down his back. And for nearly an hour, he stared at the float.
This is getting tiresome. Oh, I foresee, I fear, an adjustment to the dinner menu. I'll eat a butterfly sandwich and wait till the shower is over.
Thank you.
If I could recall exactly what provisions I have in my larder...
You beastly creature! What a nasty, underhanded thing to do.
Dear me. I trust that is not a rat.
Oh, is there no peace to be had anywhere?
I think I'd better get away from here.
Excuse me, sir.
Oh, bless my soul.
Have you seen my pocket handkins? Or even a pinafore?
Afraid not, young lady.
Oh, well.
Sorry, I can't be of more help. Eh, what?
Mama is not going to be pleased. Goodbye.
Whatever next? Dear me. Whatever would I be doing with pocket handkins? And pinafores, indeed.
A minnow! A minnow! I have it by the nose! Hooray! Ow! Oh! Oh, dear, no! Oh! My goodness! Oh, no! Ouch! What are you doing on the end of my line, Jack Sharp? Ouch! Get off my boat this instant! Ow! Impertinent little rascals! Oh, what to do? Two such good friends. One cannot sit them down to butterfly sandwiches. And they do expect rather a good table. If only I could remember what I have in the pantry. Grasshoppers. Just the thing. I dare say I can find a bit of lettuce for Alderman Ptolemy. But...
to see the light of day. Never has the air smelled so sweet. Oh, oh, what a mercy that was not a pike. Oh, 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 my favorite rod, my basket, my only pair of galoshes. Gone, all gone. Oh, oh, no, it doesn't much matter, but I'm sure I should never have dared to go fishing again. Just look at my best Macintosh, all in tatters.
Oh, mercy me.
It was a nightmare. I assure you, truly frightful. Ah, ahoy!
Oh, Miss Lucy, here are Mr. Fisher's guests. We must be on our way. I'll do my best with your things, sir, but I can't promise they'll come up lighting you.
Thank you, Mrs. Tiggy Winkle. No, I can rely on you, ma'am.
Good evening, Sir Isaac. Good evening, Alderman.
Good evening, ma'am. Very pleasant.
Indeed.
Good evening, Alderman. Good evening, Sir Isaac.
Ah, evening, Jeremy, old chap.
But how kind, how very thoughtful. Though I have remembered you only eat salad.
Goodbye, Mr. Jeremy. Goodbye, Mr. Jeremy Fisher.
Come along now, Miss Lucy. Your mama will be looking for you. She'll have your supper on the table.
So... how
It's a long story. I'll save it for the port. Perhaps we might take a glass of pond wine with our roast grasshopper and ladybird sauce.
There now, Miss Lucy dear. Here's where you go your way and I go mine. Please remember me kindly to Miss Potter if you should see her before I do. And I dare say we'll meet another day. Good night.
But... Good night. But where's your cap? Your shawl? Your gown? If I didn't know better, Mrs. Diggy Winkle, I should think that you were nothing but a hedgehog.
Well, then how could she have found three clean pocket hankins and a penny pinned with a silver safety pin? And besides, I have seen the little door into the back of the hill. And besides, I am well acquainted with Mrs. Tiggywinkle, as you very well know.
Thank you.
I have made many books about well-behaved people. Now, for a change, I'm going to make a story about two disagreeable people called Tommy Brock and Mr. Todd. Old Mr. Bouncer was stricken in years. He lived with his son Benjamin Bunny and his daughter-in-law Flopsy, who had a young family.
Now take care of the children, Uncle Bouncer. We're going out visiting for a while.
What? Oh, yes. Of course,
there,
Flopsy, dear.
There, my dears.
Perfectly all right, my dear.
We won't be long.
No, off you go and enjoy yourselves, eh?
Do you think they'll be all right with Father Flopsy, dear?
Oh, yes. Uncle Bounce is very capable. Remember how he saved you and Peter from Mr. McGregor's garden when you were very young?
I do.
Oh, any worms down here? Oh, I doubt it. Nothing. Not even a wiggly worm. Not a worm, a wasp. Or even some frogs or tadpoles to nibble at. I shall starve at this rate. Morning, Squire.
Is that you, Brock?
How you keeping, Mr. Bouncer?
Looking after the young'uns for me son Benjamin. No problem. No worries.
Yes. They're sweet little things, aren't they?
Bear me company for a while. What's the news from downhill, eh? Tommy, me dear fella.
Oh, not so good, I'm sorry to say. A great scarcity of pheasant eggs these days. And very few frogs about. I have not had a good square meal in a fortnight. I shall have to turn vegetarian and eat me own tail.
No. Vegetarian. eat me own tail.
yes. A great scarcity of nice titbits, I'm afraid. I think it's down to the presence of old Todd the fox.
My dear chap, won't you step inside for a slice of seed cake and a glass of homemade cowslip wine to fortify the constitution?
Don't mind if I do, Squire.
Todd, eh? Don't like the sound of that.
Yes. Always a great scarcity of food when old Mr. Todd is on the trail.
Have a cabbage leaf cigar, Tommy. Go on.
Well, I say, that's uncommon decent of you. Don't mind if I do. Ah, that's grand.
Haven't seen old Sir Isaac in these parts lately, you know. Or the Alderman Ptolemy for a while, either.
No, I'm sorry to say.
Oh, well, I don't get many visitors, me. No, not like it used to be. I'm a resentful old man.
Yes. You have a nice little sleep, Mr. Bouncer. I'll take care of those nice little rabbits for you.
Uncle Bouncer!
Oh, no, what's that?
Where are the children?
Father, where are the babies?
Oh, I can smell Badger, Benjamin.
Has anyone been here?
It's old Tommy Brooke. He's taken our babies.
Now, don't worry, Flopsy. I'll catch that old rogue. Now, which way?
Oh, how could you let me down? I trusted you.
Ah, this way.
You said to look after me. I was relying on you.
Plates and pots, pots and pans, oh, baby rabbits.
Breakfast, lunch, tea and supper. Lovely grub.
Peter Rabbit!
Whatever is the matter, Cousin Benjamin?
He's bagged my family. Tommy Brooke in a sack. Have you seen him?
Tommy Brooke?
Yes!
Perhaps if you tell me from the beginning.
Flopsy and I went out visiting neighbours. Father was watching over the young ones, and old Tommy Brooke must have arrived. Well, you can guess the rest.
Cousin Benjamin, compose yourself. Because Mr. Todd is at home at the stick house, Tommy Brooke has gone to Mr. Todd's other house, at the top of Bull Banks.
Nice places.
Come quickly, Peter.
Suit me fine. Is that the time?
Cottontail, have you seen Tommy Brooke pass this way?
Yes, he rested here for a while and was laughing.
Squirrel Nutkin, have you seen Tommy Brooke? Come on, Benjamin, come on.
Come on.
I'm going as fast as I can. Wait for me, Peter. Peter, wait.
We're close behind him by the scent.
This is a terrible place, Peter.
Shh. Quiet. No, shh. Shh, Benjamin.
There were preparations upon the kitchen table which made Benjamin shudder. Preparations for one person's supper.
Quick, let's look around the other side.
What a dreadful place.
Wait, look. I can see him. He's asleep. I was right. He is here. He's gone to bed in his boots. His smelly old boots. Tommy Brooke must have entered through this window.
But he's bolted it from the inside.
Shh. I heard something. Yes. Tommy Brooke snoring.
No, another sound. It's them. They're alive.
Shh, you'll wake old Tommy Brooke.
Shh.
must remain calm. We must stay rational and plan carefully, or all will be lost. It will have to be a tunnel. It's the only way, a tunnel right under the house and into the kitchen. Then let's get on with it.
Come on!
Benjamin, it's sunrise. I think we've dug clear under the kitchen floor, so we should be able to tunnel upwards and free the babies. Shh! Who is it? It's Todd!
In my house, in my bed. I'll fix that badger. I will wake him with an unpleasant surprise.
Mr. Todd, naturally being a thin-legged person, was quite unable to lift the heavy weight to the level of the hook and rope. After considerable thought, he emptied the water into a wash basin and jug. The empty pail was not too heavy for him. He slung it up, wobbling over the head of Tommy Brock. As he could not lift the whole pailful of water at once, he ladled quarts of water into the pail by degrees. The pail got fuller and fuller, and swung like a pendulum.
What's he doing?
At last, Mr. Todd's preparations were complete. The pail was full of water. The rope was tightly strained over the top of the bed and across the windowsill to the tree outside.
What's going on?
Yes, a very rude awakening indeed. It's too tight. I'll have to gnaw through it. Got him! But no scream. No scream. Oh, this has turned out even better than I expected. Oh, I will bury that nasty person in a hole. I will bring my bedding out and dry it in the sun. I will have a thorough disinfecting with soft soap and monkey soap and all sorts of soap, and sprinkle Persian powder to remove the smell.
Good morning, my foxy whiskered friend. Just in time for breakfast, I don't think. Ah!
Let's get out of here, Benjamin. Run for it, Benjamin. Run in and get them while I watch the door.
Looking for me, private.
Flopsy! Flopsy!
Benjamin! Peter!
Thank goodness you're all safe! Well, all's well that ends well. That's what our mother always used to say.
I was a bit worried myself, actually.
Thanks for your help, Peter.
Oh, thank you.
Old Mr. Bouncer was forgiven. And they all had dinner.
Yes, Hunca Munca. I must send Winifred my new stories. I'm sure she'll be curious to know who frightened the cook so. And what you naughty mice were doing upstairs in the nursery.
Once upon a time, there was a very beautiful doll's house. It belonged to two dolls, called Lucinda and Jane. One morning they went out for a drive in a doll's perambulator. There was no one left in the nursery, and all was very quiet.
Come on, Tom Thumb, there's no one about. Let's go and see what we can find. There's no one at home. Let's have a look inside. Oh, look, Tom. What a beautiful dinner.
Yes, it's all ready. And for us. Oh, yum, yum, yum. What should we try first?
Oh, it looks so delicious.
Oh. Mm. Oh. Ow. It's not boiled enough. Look, it's hard. You have a try, Hunkamunker.
It's harder than the hams at the cheesemongers.
Oh, let it alone. It's no use. You try some of the fish. Deal with you ham.
It's no good. You can't eat it.
No, it's not for eating. Let's smash it all up.
Oh yes, let's. Oh, it's all a trick. It won't break.
Let's burn it on the fire.
Oh.
It won't burn.
Is there supper here?
While Tom Thumb was up the chimney, Hunkamunker had another disappointment. Mice set to work to do all the mischief they could.
That, and that, and that. Out, out, ooh, out.
Tom, I have an idea. This would be a nice bed for us. Let's take this bolster back to our place.
What? The bolster?
I've always wanted a feather bed.
Oh, yes.
Come along, Tom.
Well, I hope this will be worth all this work. Hunkamunker.
Oh, you see.
Oh, it's no good, Hunkamunker. It just won't go in.
Oh, yes, it will. We'll pull it through. Oh. Oh, that's lovely. Now, let's go back and see what else will be useful. This will be fine for my babies.
Oh. I can't get it in.
Oh, bother. Oh, well, leave it.
How about this broom and dustpan, Hunkamunker?
Yes, I'll bring this chair.
outer sight met the eyes of Jane and Lucinda.
Nurse, what has happened?
Oh, it must be mice.
I shall get a doll dressed as a policeman.
I will set a mouse trap.
And that should keep them out of the doll's house.
The birdcage was rescued from behind the coal box, but Hunca Munca had got the cradle and some of Lucinda's clothes. And those two bad mice were not the only ones causing trouble.
Quick, Hunca Munca, the kitchen!
What is it?
Who's that?
Call the cats!
But who in the world is this?
I'm Timmy Willy.
You're Tim... Well, you're very welcome, I'm sure. I'm Johnny Townmouse.
How do you do?
Let me introduce you to my friends.
Oh, thank you.
How do you do? Very pleased to meet you there. Don't take this.
Whatever.
Lovely to see you.
Thank you very
much.
Yes.
I suppose in your travels you haven't been in a trap?
No. What is a trap?
Oh, obviously not. Never mind.
Splendid piece of Stilton. What? Fine bit of tea.
Nice error.
Bacon.
Nice bit of dipping.
So sorry.
never mind. The plates don't belong to us. They come from the doll's house upstairs. You're not from around these parts, are you?
Well, no. You see, I was born in the country, in a beautiful garden. I came here by mistake. It was the hamper, the vegetable hamper. I saw it by the gate and I climbed in. It was full of lovely vegetables. And then I fell fast asleep.
Yep.
Thank you, my man. And here's sixpence for you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Oh, so much to do. Oh, so much to do.
Then there was all that awful screaming, and I fell in here.
And you're most welcome. Now, why don't those youngsters come back with our desserts? Ah, jelly. Just the thing. What's the joke, you two?
Oh, it's that silly cat chasing us.
That's all.
A cat. Oh, I don't feel very well.
Do try some jelly, Timothy William. No? Well, then, would you rather go to bed?
Yes, I would.
I will show you a most comfortable sofa pillow. Come along.
Good night, Timothy William.
Good night, Timothy William.
Timothy William. Good night.
Good night.
It is the best bed, and I keep it exclusively for visitors. Have a good night's sleep, and I hope you feel better in the morning. Good night, Timmy.
Oh,
wish I was home. Johnny Townmouse and his friends are all very kind, but... Oh, dear. Oh, dear, oh, dear.
It was the same the following nights, until one morning.
What is the matter, Timothy William? Are you ill? Every day you seem to be getting a little thinner. Aren't we feeding you well enough?
Oh, no. No, it's just that I'm not feeling so well. And I do so miss my home in the peaceful sunny bank. All this excitement isn't good for me.
Oh. Where is your home, Timmy?
In my garden with the most beautiful flowers, where I sit and listen to my friends, the birds.
Is that all? It sounds like... it sounds rather a dull place.
Oh, no, not at all. Even when it rains, I sit in my little sandy burrow peeping out of the throstles on the lawn and talk to my friend, Cock Robin. And when the sun comes out, you should see my garden. Oh, there's no noise except for the birds.
Oh,
and the bees.
No, here comes that cat again.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear.
Yes. Well, I must confess, I am a little disappointed. We have endeavoured to entertain you, Timothy William.
Oh, yes. Yes, you've been most kind, but... Oh, I do feel so ill.
Well, it may be that your teeth and digestion are unaccustomed to our food. Oh. Perhaps it might be wiser for you to return the way you came, in the hamper.
Oh?
Yeah, to your own home, in the, country.
Oh!
Why, of course... For that matter, we could have sent you back last week. Did you not know the hamper goes back empty on Saturdays?
Ramunka Munka.
Oh, thank you. Goodbye, Tom Thumb, and all of you.
I have that hamper, ma'am.
Goodbye, Timothy William.
Goodbye, Johnny Townmouse. Do try and visit me in the country one day, won't you? Hmm?
Right, I'm coming!
Oh, dearie me, mice.
Yep.
Timmy Willie settled happily again to his life in the garden. Sometimes, on Saturdays, he went and looked at the hamper lying by the gate. But he knew better than to get into it again. The winter passed, and the sun came out again. Timmy had nearly forgotten his visit to town, when who should appear?
Ah! Hello, Timothy William!
Johnny! What a surprise!
I thought I would pay you a return visit.
Yes. And you've come at the best of times. Oh, we can sit in the sun and have herb pudding.
It is a little damp.
There you are, Johnny. Try some of this. How's Tom Thumb and all our friends, eh?
The reason I've come to visit is because the family have gone to the seaside for Easter. And Cook is spring cleaning with special instructions to clear us all out. There are now 4 kittens.
Oh, no.
And the cat has killed the canary.
Oh, my goodness.
They say we did it.
Oh.
But I know better. As for Tom Thumb, well, he told the small mice all about a trap.
Goodness.
That the nurse had set for them. And Hunka Munka has become quite good friends with the policeman doll.
Mm.
Although he never says anything and always looks quite stern.
Well, it all sounds very exciting.
What? What is that fearful noise?
It's only a cow. They're quite harmless. Unless they happen to lie down on you. Come along, let's get some milk.
Oh, milk?
It does seem such a long time ago that I went to town. That seems ages, really. It really is a most fearful journey. Oh, it's terrible. Was the hamper comfortable?
Yeah! Hide! What's wrong with your friend, Timmy Willie?
Well, he's not used to the country yet.
How's that? Where's he from, then?
He's from the town.
I see. Oh, well, must be off. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Cock Robin. Come along, Johnny, we haven't got all day.
What manner of creature comes sneaking up on? Dear. Barely got myself a cock.
Whatever is that fearful racket? What? All that? Oh, sorry, a lawnmower. Now, if you just wait here, I will go and get the milk.
Crikey.
Oh,
who's that? Oh, thank goodness you're back. Oh, that seemed to take forever.
Now, let's get some grass clippings.
For
your bed. This way, Johnny. Hold the milk. I'll be back shortly.
Oh, I hope you won't be long. Oh, dear me, my tail is getting all wet. Just look at my jacket. Oh, what could he be up to? Oh, I wish he would hurry up.
Oh, it's only a spring shower, Johnny.
The milk's getting wet.
Here, take this leaf. Hold it over your head. There, like this. Oh, the rain will brighten up the flowers. Come along, Johnny. There you are now, lovely. Now, Johnny, I'm sure you'd better settle in the country, eh? Don't you think?
Well, we'll see. I can't go back anyway. The hamper is stopped while the family is at the seaside. Oh.
I'm sure you will never want to live in town again.
But he did. He went back in the very next hamper of vegetables. He said it was too quiet. Johnny got back safely to his townhouse and his old friends. And Tom Thumb paid for everything he broke. He found a crooked sixpence under the hearth rug. And on Christmas Eve, he and Hunca Munca stuffed it into one of the stockings of Lucinda and Jane. And very early every morning, before anybody is awake, Hunca Munca comes with her broom and dustpan to sweep the dolly's house. As for Timmy Willie, well, he stayed in the country, and he never went to town again. One place suits one person, another place suits another person. For my part, I prefer to live in the country, like Timmy Willie.
Just to